righteous and true. I am the grateful one, dumbfounded by you. You are the mighty one, able to save. I am the broken one, in need of your grace.
Ephesians chapter 1. Verses 13 and 14. We started a journey tackling a subject that really encompasses all of Scripture and really concentrates itself in the New Testament Scripture. We've entitled this journey or this study, "We Live in a Spiritual House, Not a Social House." It almost seems like church today is more concerned about making their programs and inner workings of the church socially acceptable rather than spiritually acceptable. Junior Hill said one time, in a conference I was in quite a few years ago, and I don't know if anyone knows who Junior Hill is, but Junior Hill was a Southern Baptist evangelist, and he said, "We only have, as preachers, one audience. We only have to please one person, and that is God Himself. If I leave the pulpit," he said, "pleasing God and handling His word faithfully and honoring His Son wonderfully and presenting His gospel clearly," he says, "I've done my job." Now, do we have more people in the congregation who are listening? Yes. But our goal is not to please them. Our goal is to give them what pleases Him, so they can in turn do those things that bring glory to God themselves, or come to know Him personally. So this is a spiritual house. And we looked at all of that. We began the journey and said, "I'm going to show you four comforts that this comforter brings, this helper called the Holy Spirit, brought to His church, brought to the individuals that make up the church, which is those who have believed in Christ." And we began looking at, we're going to find the comfort of His work in us. And then we're going to see His work for us, His work through us, and the expanse of His ministry. But we began by looking at His work in us, because that's where it begins. It begins nowhere else. And His work in us involves two aspects of our spiritual life. Listen, this is a spiritual life, not another social entity you belong to. It demands spiritual food, a spiritual walk, spiritual power, a supernatural work by the hand of God. Well, there are two aspects to that: salvation and sanctification. Well, you can't be sanctified until you're what? Saved. So we have to look at salvation. You don't even have the Holy Spirit until you're what? You can all tell me. Just make sure. Saved. You cannot have the Holy Spirit until you're what?
Saved.
So we've been looking at that, at the salvation aspect of His work in us. And it brings great comfort. We saw that at salvation, He redeems us. At salvation, He relocates us. And I'd like to take the time to go through every high point of these notes. If I did that, we wouldn't even get to today's message. So the only thing I can say is it must be on YouTube. I don't know how to even, you know, everybody talks about YouTube. My wife has to help me get there. You know what I'm saying? When I hear the word YouTube, I think of some new type of tube that goes in the tire. I'm not sure. But anyway, then last week we finished, the week before last, we finished up the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the redeeming ministry of the Holy Spirit. He regenerates us, brings us back to life, gives us new life, spiritual life. Then he takes us out of our old life and places us in the new, which is the church. But we can't leave without looking at the third aspect to this redemptive, saving work of the Holy Spirit. And that is the sealing ministry. Well, we discovered this word in its context here in Ephesians. And in studying it, I said, man, we got to get kind of the backdrop of the context, the book, to know why the apostle is using this word in this place to give illustration to this ministry of the Holy Spirit. You know, in life, there are very few guarantees. As a matter of fact, if you buy something and they give you a warranty or a guarantee, you always have to read the fine what? And it never works out for the buyer. It usually works out for the seller. There are very few guarantees. But in this context, we're going to discover some great guarantees, not based on me, not based on my ability to keep it or get it, but based on the sovereign hand of God to give it by grace. And these are guarantees that you can take home, and for lack of a better term, you can take to the bank. But let's get an idea of the greater context of the book itself. Now, Ephesus was a poor city. It was a church that the Apostle Paul started, kind of got started on his second journey, but really spent some time there on his third missionary journey, and he spent a couple years there. Let's talk about Ephesus for a bit. It's a poor city. It was located in the Roman province of Asia, which is modern-day Turkey, if you want to look on a map and figure out where that was. It was a very wealthy city. A lot of commerce in this large port that would, a lot of buying and selling of goods and shipping them to their buyers and bringing them back to sell even there. It had one of the ancient seven wonders of the world, the temple of the goddess Dinah. If you know your church history or your book of Acts, this is where Paul got into an uproar there. Remember, you know, the guy that was kind of the chief craftsman of making the little statues of Dinah, and they made a lot of money by selling them to the people because people were just trying to find some sort of religious relic to worship so they could have some sense of man-made religion. And Paul came in, preached the gospel showed up, and people stopped buying the idols. And this guy was all upset because his religion was going bad. Or was he really upset because his bank account was going down? And then there was a big uproar and all of that, big controversy, and we don't have time to unpack that. The city was steeped in idolatry and superstition. It was a center of education. It was a political center for that region, for the Empire of Rome. So it was a pretty robust, large, functioning city. Then enters Paul and the gospel. And it just gets turned upside down. Well, Paul got the church started, then he left. He left Timothy there and some others there to work with the church and help it grow. Then he wound up in prison. And this is what we call one of Paul's prison epistles. He writes him a letter. And by the way, this letter was not really meant to reprimand like Galatians and a few others, Corinthians and others. It wasn't meant to reprimand or correct bad theology. It really was to encourage and warn. Encourage them of what they had in Christ and warn them from allowing worldly influences and non-biblical influences to creep in and change what was already there. The book could really be split in half. The first three chapters are doctrinal, and they give us our position in Christ. Just listen to this. Just follow this with me. We can't unpack it, but just follow with me. Chapter 1 shows us our position as children of grace. In verse 7 of chapter 1, we see this. Look at verse 7. In him. In who? Who is the him? Christ. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. I stand here saved by grace. I didn't earn it. I didn't deserve it. Yet he, by his wonderful love and care for me, willingly, freely gave it to me. And if you're here today saved, you can say the same thing. Woo, that gets me excited. Doesn't it? Just think about it. We're children of grace. We can cry, as it says in Scripture, Abba, Father. Then in chapter 2, he says, now your position is all because of his mercy. In the most famous verses that we all know of chapter 2, 2, 8, and 9, aren't they? For by grace you're saved. Through faith is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Paul takes a few moments to show you where you were, where you are, and then he says, it's not only because of his grace, but because of his mercy. Look at verse 4 of chapter 2. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us. He loved you so much. You can't have mercy without grace. You can't have grace without mercy. Grace says, I'm going to give you what you didn't earn. Mercy says, I'm not going to give you what you deserve. They go hand in hand. I am saved by his grace because of his mercy. My position and the riches I enjoy in Christ and the riches I look forward to in Christ in glory are by his grace because of his mercy. And I'm giving you just an overview, trying to refrain myself from climbing into some of the verses so we can get to where we got to go. Then you come to the last part of the first part of the book, which is doctrinal, in chapter 3. Not only do you have a grace gift because of God's mercy, but now you have a precious relationship that is second to none. Look at verse 19 of chapter 3. To know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge, that you may be filled with the fullness of God. How deep is the Father's love for us? It's kind beyond all measure. Do we really understand this depth? And the book of Ephesians will clearly, if you read through the book and begin to tear it apart yourself with a good study Bible, you begin to see the beauty of his grace and mercy in a relationship. As Paul always, or most always, writes in his epistles especially, the first part of the book deals with the doctrinal issues. But Paul was a firm believer in what I call practical theology. And what I mean by that is, theology is worthless if all it is facts. It has to take the facts and put them to your feet. It needs to change how I live. So then Paul spends the next three chapters dealing with what this means practically. Here's my position. Now, what does it mean for me practically? Well, in chapter 5, or chapter 4, I should say, he said, the first thing it does, this position, this relationship, this grace, this mercy, demands that you live in unity. Now, there's one we need in the books, amen? You see, how in the world is everybody in this congregation, everybody with different backgrounds, different professions, different personalities going to get along? Well, in ourselves, it can't happen. That's why we read in verse 3 of chapter 4, endeavoring, see that word endeavoring, circle it, to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Whose job is it to protect unity? Whoever's job it is, please raise your hand. Everybody's. I can never blame disharmony on Chris. Then again, I might be able to. Now, there may be a situation, but I am the one that needs to deal with it from a biblical perspective. Somebody has to be the hero in every relationship. Would you say amen? It takes work to be unified as a church. It takes work. And listen, loving one another is not something you take or get some formula from Scripture. You get up every day and make a decision, I'm loving this church. In spite of themselves and myself. Amen? My wife has to get up every day and remind herself, I am loving that husband of mine. And boy, oh boy, oh boy, does it take work. You're easy, baby. But it's a decision. The unity of the church is a decision. Look, I have board meetings. And we come together. And I don't know how many times I've said it in a board meeting. If it isn't 10 times, it's 1,000 times. We come here without personal agendas. This isn't my church. These aren't my buildings. It's his and his alone. I am his what? Servant. I'm here to serve you. We're here to serve each other. We're here to love each other. And we have to put up with each other. We have to put up with Marge, and she has to put up with me. But a practical outcome is unity. Look at verse 16 of the same chapter. From whom? Now, who was that from whom speaking to? Christ. The whole body joined and knit together, what every joint supplies according to the effect and working by which every part does its what? Causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. Listen, I need you. Amen. You keep that thought too, buddy. I'll give you 20 after church for saying that. Right? But we can't sit here and say, hey, listen, there's no matter how young they are in the Lord, how many struggles they have spiritually, to how older they are in the Lord, to how many victories they had personally, there's no second class. Amen? None. There's no little people. Though I got to get littler, according to my lovely wife and my doctor and everybody else. But I got to get going. Really got to get going. Then we come to chapter 5, and in verse 8, and he says you need to walk as children of light. You got to walk in unity. You got to walk as light in a dark world. You were once darkness. Listen, the world that you used to walk in needs to see you walking differently. Would you all say amen to that? They need to see that. The world that you were saved out of needs to see that you're different. I said last week, and I'll say it again, that statement that you hear all the time, whether it be in Christian radio or Christian music, God just loves you where you are. That's hogwash. He loves you in spite of where you are, but he never leaves you where you are. Would you say amen to that? Amen. Oh, he loves me, and where I am is not where he loves me to be, but he'll come and get me out of there and put me somewhere else. And that's what we're studying now. Then in chapter 6, we see that this whole process, in the end of his letter, Paul says, listen, this whole process of understanding our position theologically, practicing our position in a practical way, is a battle. And he says, put on the whole armor of God. Now we come to chapter 1 in the text we really want. So this is the overview of the book. And the book is dealing with our life as a spiritual entity. Our life as a spiritually saved, spiritually alive individual. Individuals gathered together to be a church. Now Paul says the number one thing I want you to understand is this life is guaranteed. Now, that doesn't mean you don't put some proactive action within it. But everything God expects and has given you to do for his glory is sealed with the Spirit of God. In chapter 3, verses 3 through 6, I see what I call your predetermined position. 7 through 9, your sovereign pardon. 10 through 12, your ultimate purpose is to glorify God. And then you come to verses 13 and 14. That's what I want to focus on this morning. You see what I call your perpetual guarantee. The word seal there is really neat. It really literally means a certificate of ownership. I want you to picture this. Paul was probably picturing the port city. And in antiquity, they had everything they purchased or owned, they put their seal on it. Whoever bought it, they would have this before Greek time. They used clay, or wax. They put a little soft wax on it, and they would have this seal, and they would put their seal on it. Let's say they walked by and bought a pallet of lumber or a pallet of grain or barrels of whatever, maybe olive oil. And the seal would go on it. It was a seal of ownership. And then in verse 14, Paul says, which is your guarantee? In other words, when someone walked by that, and they saw that seal, there were some guarantees with that. What Paul is saying is when God looks at your life, or you look at your life with the Holy Spirit sealed in you, there are some guarantees. And my friends, that's what I want us to look at this morning, is these guarantees throughout the New Testament scripture. I want to look at basically five biblical guarantees that the sealing ministry, the word seal means to authenticate ownership. We belong to Him and Him alone. And because we belong to Him, there are five guarantees you can take to the bank. So I began to think about that. Jot some things down and go to the text of Scripture where those thoughts were coming from. I'm going to say right off the bat, we're going to look at them from the sealing ministry perspective without tearing apart the inner workings of every text, because we could be there for some time. The first guarantee is we have a guarantee of security. We're secure. Just like that stack of lumber that was bought and sealed could never be touched by anyone but those whom the owner gave permission to touch. Isn't that cool? You can't be touched without your owner's permission. It's a guarantee. Let me show you what I mean. Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, beginning with verse 12. And like I say, I don't really want to, I wish I could unpack these, but when we study Romans in the near future, we will unpack them. Hopefully, Ron will still be here when that happens, but I'll try to speed it along, Ron. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh. Listen, you owe the flesh nothing, young people. And adults alike. The flesh no longer can touch you unless you let it do so. That's a guarantee to live according to the flesh. Right down through verse 16. For if you live according to the flesh, you will. Now let me stop there for a minute. Paul here is showing the difference between saved and lost. And a lost individual can sit in the pew and say they're saved, but they're living in a constant desire to please the flesh. There's something wrong with their what? It's got to be. If they have no guilt, no remorse, no passion to get it right. Paul says, you're probably going to die spiritually. But if by the Spirit you put to death, see, here's the difference. How many of you like to hunt? I used to. I used to hunt all the time. Then they made it buck only and took 50% of my opportunity away. And I'm not a really keen hunter. You know, the deer in Bradford used to figure out where I was going to hunt and all gather there. That's how good I was. But anyway, in hunting, you're going to shoot something or shoot a deer or shoot a moose, and you're going to put it to what? Death. Listen, this is telling me that the true believer lives their life battling the flesh and putting to death its desires every day. The non-believer doesn't care. And the Spirit of God guarantees that it will help and protect me from the flesh getting me if I use the ministry that He has been given to do so. You'll live. Verse 14. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. Listen, I sensed the leading of the Spirit the moment I said, Jesus, save me. If you don't sense it, it wasn't sincere. At the lowest level, the youngest level of infancy in Christian life, you know the Spirit's there. Verse 15. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption, by whom we cry, what? Abba, Father. Verse 16. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. I wrote something down, and I know that it might be shocking to you, but I wrote something down as I was thinking about this. And I said, you must never rely on a past prayer. Ooh, I'm stepping on some traditional toes now. But you must rely on the growing evidence of the Spirit leading in your life. Amen? You know, I know 100 people say, well, when I was in Bible school, when I was 8 years old, I went forward and prayed this little prayer. Haven't been in church in 45 years. Don't care about going to church, but I know I prayed that prayer. That means nothing. Not according to Scripture. I get excited when I hear little ones pray that prayer in Bible school. I do. I get excited when my granddaughter said she asked Jesus to be your Savior. But I don't rely on that. I rely on her coming to the understanding of the evidence of the Spirit of God in her life as she grows older, physically and spiritually. And if she don't sense that, my prayer is she really comes to a knowledge of who he really is. Because that's the evidence of salvation. It isn't some date. I talk to people about, well, I don't have a real date. Well, it isn't about a date. It's about an evidence. The text we just read didn't say, well, the Spirit himself reminds you of the day that you asked Jesus to be your Savior and prayed that sinner's prayer and you were saved. No, the Spirit himself beareth witness with my spirit within me. When I lay my head on my pillow at night, even though my life has not been stellar today, I know I'm saved. Amen? And if you can't say that, you're on scary ground. Don't rely on some date 3 years ago, 4 years ago, 40 years ago, or whatever it was. Rely on the evidence of the Spirit of God that's sealed your life today. Amen? Well, I was going to go through verses 31 through 39, but we don't have that time. Write that down, read through them. Just jump to verse 31 for a second. Let me read. You'll know them. It says, what shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be what? Verse 32. Comes right after verse 31. Oh, there it is. Yeah. Who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Then it goes on, for I'm convinced that there is neither death nor life, nor principality, nor power, nor height, nor depth, nor anything can separate me from the love of Christ. You know why I'm convinced of that? Because the Spirit is in me. I am secure in him. I don't worry about my position in him. I am concerned with how I practice that position. The second thing, the guarantee we have, is we have a guaranteed protection. In John 14, verse 16 says, if I send the comforter, if I go away, I will send the comforter to you, or my Father will send the comforter to you. That word means helper. And I just want to run through this real quick. It really means one called alongside to help. And I got thinking about this. How does he protect me? If I'm sealed, I'm guaranteed to be secure. If I'm sealed, I'm guaranteed to have protection around me and within me. Well, he does that many ways. And we're going to look at it deeper as we go into his ministry. Through guidance. He guides me through the word. Through conviction. He warns me of that which is wrong. Through instruction from the pulpit, from other entities, through reading good books or studying the scripture, he instructs you. Through illumination, he opens your eyes to the truth. And I could go on and on and on. But everything he does to protect me revolves around this. And it really bothers me that this is being put to the side and experience is being brought to the forefront in churches today. This is what you need. This is what your children need. This is what your grandchildren need. The best way I could illustrate it is, let's say I went to Africa. And I wanted to take a tour through the jungle. And I wanted to be protected as I went on that journey. Who would I hire? A guide. A well-respected guide. A guide that knew the terrain. A guide that knew what I should wear and what I should not wear. A guide that knew where I should step and not step. And that would guarantee my what? Safety, protection. And God says, I've sealed you with the Holy Spirit of God, and he's your guarantee of security, but he's also your guarantee of protection. You just need to listen to him. If that guy said, don't go down that path, I went down that path, got ate by a lion, whose fault was that? Mine. The lion would be satisfied, but my day wouldn't go so well. If I was on the trail and that guide said, you know what, this trail goes up this way, stay close to the wall because the outer edge is very shaly and slippery and the rocks fall away and you will fall to your death, what should I do? Stay close to the wall for my protection. The Spirit of God is your seal of protection. He guides you into all truth. He convicts you. He corrects you. He instructs you. He's instructing you this morning. I'm just a voice piece. There's things he wants you to understand before you leave here today. So you have the guarantee of security and protection. And thirdly, you have the guarantee of ownership. You see, when they put that stamp on there, the individual whose seal was on that item, he owned it. It was ownership. Well, look at 1 Corinthians 6, 19 through 20. You probably could quote these verses, some of you. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit? Boy, I wish we realized that. Who is where? Where is he? Whom you have from God, and you are not your own, for you were bought at a price. And what was that price? The blood of Jesus Christ. Therefore, glorify God in your body that is in your and in your spirit, which are whose? God's. Listen, my body, my life belongs to him. And I have an obligation to honor him with it. I have an obligation to yield to his will. He has a right to do with it as he pleases. If he wants to make it ill, he can. If he wants to move it from one place to another, he can. My hands are his. My feet are his. He owns me. Sold. But you know what the beauty of that is? Think about it for a minute. If he paid the price to own me, I can never be for sale again. Paid in full. So I must surrender to his will. Fourthly, I really want to labor on this a little bit. Not only is it a guarantee of security, a guarantee of protection, and a guarantee of ownership. But it's a guarantee of authenticity. There's a lot of I'm born againism around. Well, I'm a person of faith, whatever that means. But when you're sealed with the Holy Spirit, there's an authenticity about it that you can see, that he can see, and what I believe we'll see in a moment will become evident for all to see. Let me show what I mean. 2 Corinthians 1, 21 and 22. Now he who establishes us with you in Christ, now he is speaking about God, has anointed us in God, who has sealed us and given us the Spirit in our, where? Say it again, where? As a guarantee, verse 22. Oh, is that both of them? Well, my. You know what I wrote down? My authenticity is a heart issue. Not some historical moment. And over time, it will authenticate my saving identity. If he rules in my heart, there has to be a place of change. At the youngest level, to the oldest believer, there is something different now. Things are different now. Something happened to me when I gave my heart to him. Things I loved before have what? Passed away. Things I love far more have come to what? I got saved when I was 19 years old. I believe my intervention with God was at a party I was at with my friends. I believe my day that I made it public was at a crusade that I went to with my mom a few days later. But the night that God really convicted me of my need of Christ, and I really just said, Lord, save me. I woke up the next day. And I want to tell you something, things were different. I didn't understand it, couldn't explain it. I knew I needed to go to church. I knew, as a matter of fact, I was a pretty, good boy. Metaphorically speaking, in a way. If you believe that, I have oceanfront property in Colorado to sell you, but I was not a real good boy. I was pretty rebellious, actually. I did everything I could to make everybody around me miserable. I did everything I could to chemically induce happiness. I woke up that day and my mom had a habit of asking me to go to different church services. I always would say, too busy. She met me in the hallway and she says, hey, Jerry Falwell's having a I Love America crusade. Our church is going down to it in Bangor. That dates it a little bit, doesn't it? She said, I would like to have you go with us. I said, sure. And after they revived her, we went. I went that night, and I really don't remember what was preached. Didn't really pay attention. Maybe like some not doing today, I'm not sure. But anyway, I went that night, and I didn't go there for that reason. I remember one song. You remember, how many here remember the name Robbie Heiner? You all remember Robbie Heiner? Maybe. Wow, that really dates me. Nobody, Ron's not even right with it again, but anyway, he sang that song, I Want That Mountain. That's the only song I can remember. But I knew something happened 3 or 4 days earlier in a drunken, drug-infested party where God met me in a corner and said, you're going straight to hell. And I said, no way. He said, yes way. And I said, no way. He said, absolutely. I said, Lord, get me out of here. And the party broke up. I went home. I went there that night to walk an aisle. Not because I thought I had to, because I wanted people to know that something happened to me. I remember I was standing beside my sister. I remember explaining the day. And they had prayed for me for years. When my mom comes, you see all those beautiful gray hairs in her head. 30% of them belong to my brothers and the other 70 to me. But I just did whatever my brothers did on steroids. Not proud of that. No one would think I would walk an aisle. All I heard was the first letter of the word come. You know why? Because it was in my heart. Something happened that night when I met God face to face. Not literally, metaphorically, but He convicted me of my sin, convinced me of my destiny, and said the only solution to that was coming to Christ. And that's what I did. But I want to tell you something. I don't base my authenticity on a date. Matter of fact, my wife has to remind me what date it was sometimes. It was 1979? 77? Oh, I graduated from Bible school in 79, 80. Okay. Well, can't get that date right. We was married in 1982, though, right? No, 83? No, 82. I better get that date right. Right, Skip? I'll be in trouble. But I base my authenticity on the evidence of the inner working of the Spirit of God in me from day one. And there's got to be a change, a new passion, a new desire, a new hunger. I wanted to go to church. I knew I had to go to church. I knew I had to give up drinking, and I had to give up running around with the boys. I'll tell you the story. I went into the store about three, maybe 2 months later, and there was a guy by the name of Paul. I won't give you his last name. I mean, he was a guy I ran with, and he says, hey, Don Niles, how you doing? Haven't seen you in a while lately. I said, yeah. He said, hey, you been going to church? I go, yeah, yeah. I said, so he says, you're one of those Christians now, right? I go, yeah. He says, I'll be down to have a glass of milk with you. I said, go right ahead. Or another friend of mine, Ricky, was there with him, and he came down a few days later. I've been saved maybe 2 months, 3 months. I didn't know what the gospel was. I didn't know how to share it. I remember sitting on the stump. He let me take a ride in his dirt bike. I love dirt bikes. He just bought a brand new, I think it was a Yamaha 600. That's another story, but anyway. And then we sat down and I shared with him what had happened to me. You see, I wasn't authenticated by a date. I was authenticated by the moving and the working of the Holy Spirit of God, giving me the ability to share what I didn't understand, but I knew was true. It's in my heart. Day one. It's not based on some moment you had a few years ago. That might have been the point. Maybe it was last week and you realize, hey, I need to believe in Jesus. I don't care if you're sitting in this chair right there walking out that door. If you believe in Jesus, guess what? Guess what? If you can sense the moving of the Holy Spirit in your life, you can sense His presence, you can cry, Abba, Father, you can rest in His hope, you're saved. You don't have to walk an aisle and pray a prayer. You can walk an aisle and pray a prayer, but that's not the key. The key is the divine intervention of God. I wasn't saved at the Isle of America crusade. I made it public. If you were saved recently, you have plenty of chance to make it public through baptism. First John. Oh. I'm so thankful. Let's wrap this up. 1 John chapter 2, verse 20 and 21. Dealing with the subject of authenticity. Because to be honest with you, if you don't sense the authenticity of your conversion, you have no guarantee of security. You have no guarantee of protection. You have no guarantee. That guarantee is based on how authentic you are, how real it is. And the realness isn't based on some date you can remember or some card you have in your pocket or some time in history where you went to a Bible school and got saved. That may be part of God's drawing process, but the real authenticity of it is when you know He's in you and understand it completely. And because of that, things change. But you have an anointing. And start with that. That's the same Greek word as the word sealed. The same Greek word family. But you have an anointing, and the King James Version says you have an unction. That's where we get the old camp song. Give me unction in my gumption. Help me function, function, function. Give me unction in my gumption, I pray. But anyway, that's where that song came from. I just don't know what that has to do with the message, but it came to my mind. But you have an anointing from the Holy One, and you know all things. Now, how many here knows everything? Now, some think you do. Chris. Yeah, well, that's kind of in the genes, I think, but anyway. Whoops. I just lost lunch. All of us think we know a lot anyway, most of the time. But we do know all things pertaining to what? My salvation, my hope in Christ. Listen, no one had to tell me I was saved. The day I came to Christ, I woke up knowing I was saved. Didn't know what it meant. I didn't know what propitiation, justification, glorification. I didn't know all those words meant. But I knew I was saved. I knew something happened to me. Because listen, salvation isn't just a decision. It's a divine intervention where a supernatural event takes place where God reaches into your life and regenerates you, relocates you, and then He seals you, and you are changed forevermore. We're taking the miracle out of conversion today. And it's miraculous. Amen? You know all things. I've not written to you because you do not know the truth, but because you know it. and that no lie is of the truth. It's not based on some knowledge of what you did. It's based on a knowledge you have supernaturally in your life. And you see what he is doing. But you wake up the next day and the birds are singing and they're a little bit sweeter to you. You wake up the next day and the sun is rising and you take notice of it a little bit more. You wake up the next day and you can say, I know I have blessed assurance. I have no idea what that means. You go to church that first Sunday after you're first saved and you hear them sing that song. And in your heart you say, I know, I feel that. Don't completely understand it, but I know it's there. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. Day one. See, that's a supernatural work of the hand of God. That's how I was saved, and that's how every individual is saved prior to mine and beyond mine. And that's what we believe here at Grace. I firmly believe that if God grips your heart in the middle of one sermon, you're done. Because he's the surgeon. And if you're sitting here and you don't have any concern about that, any passion for that, any burden for that, doesn't mean much to you, you're probably lost. You say, oh, but I prayed a prayer. I don't care. Don't care. Well, the guy that led me in that prayer told me I was saved. I really don't care about that either. No one has to tell me, I know. I don't have to be told I'm saved. Even on my worst day, when I struggle the most with my flesh, I know I'm saved. Because I base it on him. And his grace. Well, I get the final guarantee, and I'm going to run right through it real quick. When you step on that port and you see this seal on this item that's been purchased, it guarantees several things. It guarantees security. It belongs to that individual, and that item is safely in their hands. It guarantees protection. It can't be stolen or bought again. It guarantees authenticity, right? I missed one. Hold on.
Ownership,
thank you. Guarantees ownership. And lastly, it guarantees the assurance of final delivery. That item would be loaded on a ship. And it will be taken to its final destination, the owner's house. Oh, does that get you excited? If that's getting you excited, then you're probably pretty authentic. Because I'm getting really excited. I'm going home. This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures I laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. I'm going home. I can't wait to get there. There are days I long for heaven. I love my children. I want to see them all grow up. But you know what? If God knocked on my door and said, come, I wouldn't refuse. Can't wait to get there. And those who are truly saved, I believe, have the same feeling. Amen? Now, while I'm here, I'm going to live my life for his glory. I'm going to enjoy the things I enjoy, whether it be hunting, fishing, whether it be baseball, softball, lacrosse, hockey, Football, yeah, that's, listen, never mind. Football. Had a kid on the bus say, was you ever involved in athletics, Mr. Niles? I go, yeah, I belong to the hooky team. They said, well, what was that? I said, you don't want to know. They said, what did you play? I said, I played hooky. No, but anyway. anyway. I'm going to enjoy sunshine and rain, and I'm going to live. I'm going to enjoy the work that I do here at the church and the work that I do in the community. I'm going to enjoy living for Christ, serving Christ, and I'm going to practice the very things that the last three chapters of Ephesians challenged me to practice. But one thing I'm going to rest in, I'm guaranteed security, protection. I am guaranteed ownership. I am guaranteed authenticity. And I'm guaranteed I'll be taken home. Because at the day I got saved, I was signed, sealed, and one day will be delivered. Philippians 1:6 says, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will perform until the day of Jesus Christ. It's a guarantee. Not because of me, but because of Christ. And you are either living in that guarantee or need to be in that guarantee today. That's the two places you are. You're either saved and you know it, or you're lost and you know it, or you're just thinking you're saved and don't know it. But if you don't have a passion in your heart for the things of God, you're living in dangerous territory. Amen? Well, now we begin to look at the second aspect of his work in us. If you think this was exciting, now we look at the subject of sanctification, what he's doing in us beyond the operation of conversion and in the operation of construction into the image of his Son. See, that's why I don't believe that we should preach a gospel where God loves you where you are and doesn't mind where you are and is okay with where you are and it's okay to make mistakes. He does not love you where you are. He loves you in spite of where you are, and he never leaves you there. He wants to bring you out and grow you up. Would you say amen to that?
Hear ye, hear ye. Prepare for an amazing adventure that will take you over the moat. Hello, everyone. My name is Finnegan Fox. I am the palace's royal messenger. I bring a special announcement directly from the palace. You are invited to come with us to the other side of the moat. That's right, inside the castle. We're going to have all sorts of fun and learn a lot about giving praise to God, the King of all the earth.
Each day, students will head off to the courtyard for a time of worship and singing. They may even get to meet Finnegan and his friends. Throughout the day, they'll explore castle life. Working at the smithy, they'll forge meaningful crafts that will remind them to praise God for years to come. They'll sharpen their skills when they head out to the field for royal competitions. And when they get hungry from all the jousting and other games, they'll return to the castle's great hall to feast on a banquet of snacks fit for a king.
Well, I'd love to stick around, but I need to make more announcements.
Aye, farewell for now, Finnegan. You know, the best part of each day is when we get to talk about who God is and what he has done. By looking at the life of David, David knew that God was his refuge, strength, shield, and fortress. David continually sang praises to his king. Psalm 47, 6 and 7 say, sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises unto our king, sing praises. For God is the king of all the earth. On day one, students will learn to approach God with love. God chose David to be anointed by Samuel. Students will be encouraged to have a heart that is pleasing to God.
But what does that mean? Well, it means to love God and want to please him in everything you think and everything you do and everything you say.
On day two, students will learn to trust God for strength and courage. God empowered David to fight Goliath. Students will identify tasks that require courage and strength, things they can trust God for. On day three, students will learn to praise God because he is worthy. God protected David through Jonathan's warning. Students will discover ways to praise God, even when times are hard. On day four, students will learn to tell others about God. God crowned David King of Israel. Students will honor God by telling others about him.
All you have to do is tell people about all the amazing things God has done for you.
On the last day, students will learn to thank God for his faithfulness. God promised David that his son Solomon would become king and would build the temple. God always keeps his promises.
We've been talking about singing praises to God. Now let's decide that we will praise God, our King, in good times and hard times. That doesn't just mean singing songs. We want to praise God with everything we do. Our lives should show how much we love him. I do hope you will join us. Ooh, I've got to go. I need to spread this message to everyone, everywhere. Farewell, my friends, and I'll see you over the moat.